Namaskar and a very warm welcome to the session this morning. To all, special welcome to our esteemed panelists who have joined us, and an even more special welcome to the 2,000 plus participants who have actually joined us on this webinar. As you all know, we began this yesterday. We had a fabulous inaugural where our tourism minister gave a very motivating inaugural address. We focused on several areas in the panels yesterday, but today our focus is actually, our spotlight is on the hidden tourism jewels of India. We haven't explored our own country enough, and we do want to look at the fabulous unexplored tourism potentials that we have. We have panelists across. There's Mr. Sachin Ramachandra Jadhav, IAS Director of Tourism, Government of Orissa. A warm welcome to you, sir. Mr. Cyril Diengaw, IAS Director of Tourism, Government of Meghalaya. A warm welcome to you, sir. Mr. J.K. Mahanti, Co-Chairman, FICCI Tourism Committee and CMD Swasti Group. Welcome to you, Mr. Mahanti. Mrs. Shubha Chaturvedi, Head Communications and Senior Coordinator Marketing and Promotions, Chhattisgarh Tourism Board. Mr. Jaspreet Singh Bhatia, Founder, Ice Cubes Holidays. Mr. Sanjeev Kurup, President, Ayurveda Promotion Society and Managing Director, Ayurveda Mana Hospitals. Suyashi Keshari, Wildlife Presenter and Filmmaker. And we have none other than Mr. Vinod Zutshi, who is going to be moderating this session. Mr. Zutshi is known to all of us. He's been the former Secretary of Tourism of Government of India and a passionate believer in the potential of tourism. So Mr. Zutshi, thank you so much for acceding to our request to moderate this session. I'm now going to hand over to Randhir Vikram Singh, who's the co-chairman of FICCI Rajasthan State Council, to give a brief welcome and to take the session forward. Namaskar. Thank you. Over to you, Vikram.
Right. Thank you, Mrs. Suri. Namaskar to everybody. Good morning. And a very warm welcome to everybody, especially the delegates and all the guests today on this show. This is the first session of this day. And I'm happy to welcome Mr. Vinod Zutshi, an old friend, and our former Secretary, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, and who's been a wonderful mentor for FICCI. I've known him since Rajasthan days when we were doing tourism together. I'm also very happy to welcome Mr. Sachinji and Cyrilji, who are the leading two India's most beautiful destination, Orissa and Meghalaya. And we'd like to also welcome Mrs. Subhuda Chaturvedi, who's representing another beautiful state, Chhattisgarh. Welcome, ma'am. These unprecedented times, as you all know, travel and tourism has been badly affected. It's been 5 months now that we have been affected by this crisis, and the focus for the tourism stakeholders now is to find a way to revive the tourism and recover it sooner than later. The pandemic has changed how people will travel, and one's safety is the main priority today. To look at niche tourism segments that will capture the demand in the new ecosystem, I'm happy that we will be discussing these new segments, example, eco and ethn tourism, culinary tourism, Ayurveda and wellness tourism, adventure and wildlife tourism, culture and heritage tourism in today's panel. I'm personally very passionate with heritage tourism. I've myself been involved for the last 40 years. It is naturally blessed with when it comes to all these segments. We have an amazing panel of experts here. Our focus today will be on how we should capitalize on strengths in these segments and give India a competitive edge in the new environment. With these words, I'd like to request Mr. Vinod Zutshi, former Secretary, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, to take over the session. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Mr. Randhir. Dr. Jyotsna Suriji, Mr. Randhir Vikram Singh, the esteemed panel speakers of this session, August audience, ladies and gentlemen. Over the next 1 hour, friends, we are going to deliberate on a very relevant and pertinent topic titled Spotlight on Hidden Tourism Jewels of India and Exploring the Unexplored Tourism Potential. Now, before I give my opening remarks, I would like to introduce once again our esteemed speakers for this session. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have with us Mr. Sachin Ramchandra Jadhav. He is an IAS officer and presently Director of Tourism in Government of Odisha. We have Mr. Cyril Dingdo, again an IAS officer, Director of Tourism in Government of Meghalaya. Mr. J.K. Mohanty is the co-chairman of FICCI Tourism Committee and also the chairman and managing director of Swasti Group. Mrs. Shubhda Chaturvedi, she is the head communications and senior coordinator, marketing and promotions, Department of Tourism, Government of Chhattisgarh. Mr. Jaspreet Singh Bhatia, founder Ice Cube Holidays. Mr. Sajeev Kurup, he is the president of Ayurved Promotion Society and MD of Ayurvedamana Hospitals, Kerala. And Mr. Suyash Keshari, the wildlife presenter and a renowned filmmaker. So, ladies and gentlemen, you can see that the panel speakers are from diverse verticals of tourism world, and they're all present here. We have industry leaders from hospitality, from travel trade, from adventure, from wildlife, from wellness. And of course, we have three senior officers from the three state governments who would represent the government stand on the present topic that we are discussing. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, I would just speak about the topic of the discussion. And let me flag the point that the subject of our discussion today is definitely in the backdrop of COVID crisis through which all of us are passing through. Now, thanks to the union government, that despite being in the midst of COVID crisis, the government has unlocked the economy to the possible extent under Unlock 1, under Unlock 2. And you must have noted yesterday, the Unlock 3 guidelines have also been issued. And the redeeming feature about the Unlock 3 is that the government has opened interstate movements of people and goods without any rider. So this is going to certainly promote tourism and particularly domestic tourism. Further, because of international tourist movement will not begin for some more time. So the governments, whether union government, Ministry of Tourism, state governments, and the tourism pundits all are pitching to promote domestic tourism, which has either started or is going to trigger the revival of tourism in this country. So, and while promoting domestic tourism, ladies and gentlemen, keeping in fact the COVID threat still looming large, we are still in the midst of COVID crisis, there are certain parts of the country which are safe and some of the areas are not so safe. So it is necessary for the government and the industry to focus initially on those destinations which are relatively more health safe and focus on visitors who may like to travel short distances. So friends, there are a huge number of destinations in our country which are lesser known, which have remained unexplored, even to the people who are living in the vicinity of the destination. I'm sure that in Odisha, the people within the state would not have visited many places. So it's time, ladies and gentlemen, to unearth, to explore and showcase before the people within your state, within your district, within your region, and within the country. Of course, it will go gradually to make them, see those jewels of tourism, the gems of tourism, and start and trigger and begin with the domestic tourism. So now it's time that these hidden gems are explored and showcased to the world. It is time that necessary tourism infrastructure is put in place to make them alive and to make them working. It is also necessary that health infrastructure is also placed along with protocols in order to build the consumer's confidence. And number four, they are aggressively promoted. So the promotion strategy of these lesser known destinations or domestic tourist destinations, as I had mentioned earlier, they could begin with intrastate, followed by intra-region, and then followed by pan-India. So initially, as I have mentioned, the movement of tourists will be preferred for short distances. It could be within the district, it could be within the state, intrastate, and believe me, a large number of people, as I had mentioned, have not seen even the destinations which are lying within their own districts. So intra-region, because people like to move gradually to the states, beyond their states into the region. For example, Meghalaya can focus on the northeast and then gradually move to the other parts of the country. Similarly, gradually you will go into the pan-India sphere, and as and when the traveler's confidence increases, the interstate and pan-India domestic traveling will also begin. So in stages, if we are focusing, I think it will be better. So in all situations, showcasing and promoting lesser known and unexplored destinations should be an apt strategy for all the tourism stakeholders, including the government. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, with these opening remarks, I will pause here. We would all like to listen to the views of our esteemed panelists. And as I have mentioned, we will first of all take up questions with each panelist today. We have some video films also of some states. We have a PowerPoint presentation as well. So I will begin with our first speaker, Mr. Cyril Dingdo. As I mentioned, he's director of tourism in government of Meghalaya. And before I request him to speak and I put a question before him, could I request Mr. Manish to kindly play the video film on Meghalaya?
Manish, the film, please. Manish.
So thank you, Meghalaya, for exhibiting the video film. So Mr. Cyril, welcome to the panel discussion. We begin with you. Mr. Cyril, Meghalaya is a part of Northeast India. And as we all know, Northeast India itself is a paradise unexplored. It is also a fact that tourism assets of Northeast, including Meghalaya, have not been consumed by people of India so far. For Meghalaya, therefore, domestic tourism is, I think, the biggest driver. So at this stage, when Meghalaya is one of the few states which have also not been so much affected by the pandemic, what is going to be your government's plan, your department's plan to open Meghalaya for domestic tourists from within Northeast, from within Meghalaya, and of course from other parts of the country? What are those unexplored destinations which you have in mind, which you have put on the plate in terms of the themes which have been mentioned for the subject today, like eco-ethnotourism, culinary tourism, Ayurveda, wellness, adventure, wildlife, culture, and heritage? And what are you going to do about the strategies for marketing and for showcasing and for promoting domestic tourism at this point of time when we are still fighting with the COVID in the country and with interstate movement having started in the country lately? So can we have your views, Mr. Cyril, please?
Thank you, sir. Very good morning to you and a very good morning to all my co-panelists. Thank you for having me here. The video, I think there was some lag. I don't know if all of you could see it from where y'all were, but I'm sure you caught glimpses of the beautiful nature of Meghalaya and the tagline of Meghalaya Tourism, which is check into nature. I'll begin with your second question, sir, in terms of the potential of Meghalaya to promote various forms of tourism, particularly ecotourism and adventure tourism. I don't know if many of our audience knows, but you know, we all actually live in the Meghalayan age as of today. This is the latest geological age, and that is because of a discovery in one of the caves in the Momlo area. And because of this discovery, the International Union of Geological Sciences have classified the last 4,200 years of the Earth's history, which is 4,200 years till now, as the Meghalayan age. So to actually promote this and to showcase this unique aspect of you know, which is the heritage of the Earth, I would say, not only of Meghalaya or of our country. We had this year, early this year, hosted a festival called the Meghalayan Age Festival, in which the basic aim of this festival was to promote unexplored destinations, primarily our caving systems. Many of you may know we have some of the longest caves in the world, almost 24 kilometers in length. We have some of the beautiful living wood bridges. We have places like Shnong Pedeng, which is close to the international border at Dauki with Bangladesh, which is a hub for adventure tourism, particularly for scuba diving and for other water sports. So this festival was launched to promote these unexplored destinations of the state. So let me spend a minute talking about some of these unexplored destinations. So definitely Meghalaya has huge potential for adventure tourism, primarily caving. We also have potential for whitewater rafting, scuba diving, snorkeling in our pristine rivers. And those of you who have been to Meghalaya know about the beautiful weather, the rolling hills, the climate, the beautiful nature, basically. In the Garo Hills region, we have the Nokrek Biosphere Reserve, one of the beautiful, forests in the country, which is home to the citrus gene, the citrus fruit has originated from this area. We have places like the Balfakram National Park, and other beautiful destinations. So definitely Meghalaya, through various interventions, has been promoting these new destinations. And not only that, but also ensuring that we have developed infrastructure from various funding options we have, right from Swadesh Darshan scheme to Prasad to other schemes of Government of India. And we are also planning to develop these circuits. And the way we are planning to do it is to ensure that we ensure the sustainability of each destination, the carrying capacity of each destination is looked into so that with the communities, we build each destination as a eco-friendly destination, as a sustainable destination. Because in Meghalaya, being in the sixth schedule of the constitution, all our tourist spots are owned and managed by communities. So we have been working with them to promote such destinations. You might have heard of Maulin Nong, which is the cleanest village in Asia. With the communities, this area has been marketed over the years, and today it's one of the go-to destinations. The Living Root Bridge, the double-decker Living Root Bridge at Nong Riat is one of the Living Root Bridges. We have many of them. And in the Meghalayan Age Festival also, we promoted the destination of Kudeng Rim, which has other Living Root Bridges. So Meghalaya offers various all-round destinations for tourists. And we do it in a sense where each destination is sustainable. So especially in these COVID times, our tourists can come and enjoy the beautiful nature and landscape of Meghalaya. So that is on the unexplored potential and unexplored destinations. Recently, we also launched the Shillong Heritage Walk, which is a walk through the architectural history of this beautiful hill station of ours. And we are planning to launch more heritage walks in Sora, in Cherrapunji, in the David Scott Trail, and other such destinations. So the video showcased a few of these destinations. Coming to your first question, sir, on what is the strategy of the government? As of now, I would say that we are still closed to tourists. We have not opened up. We have opened up only to tourists within the state, and we are monitoring the situation. As although we are relatively free from COVID, cases have been increasing over the past few days. So we are tackling that on the COVID front. However, we have been taking steps to build the capacity of our service providers. As per the guidelines of the Government of India in terms of having the SOPs for our hotels, many hotels have opened up for domestic means intrastate within the state of Meghalaya tourists, and they are getting ready to be COVID compliant in terms of the SOPs. Sorry, sir, we can't hear you.
Mr. Zuchi, unmute yourself, please.
Okay. Can you hear me, Mr. Sadin?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yeah. How do you manage or cope up with the connectivity issue, Northeast in general and Meghalaya also in particular, in promoting domestic tourism? Though you have Guwahati and Shillong road completed, but the connectivity issue, especially the air connectivity and other forms of connectivity, even the roads. How do you see what kind of new infrastructure projects have been taken up to ensure that domestic tourism within Northeast and also from other parts is promoted further, and lack of infrastructure should not be an inhibitor in promoting domestic tourism?
Thank you, sir. I agree with you. Road infrastructure is crucial to reach unexplored destinations, and the government has been looking at that aspect also. We are getting funding from an externally aided project to build roads connecting last mile connectivity for tourist destinations. So that is already on the anvil. As far as air connectivity goes, Guwahati happens to be a major airport, and Shillong is only a 3-hour drive. So a lot of tourists do come in from Guwahati. However, the government has taken steps to build, to better the infrastructure at the Umroy Airport. So, there's a daily flight now from Kolkata, an IndiGo flight that lands at Umroy, which has started about a year ago. And we also are going to have a flight from Delhi, hopefully by September. So that aspect has already been finalized. And September, we're supposed to have a direct flight from Delhi to Shillong Airport, which is the Umroy Airport, which is about 18 kilometers from Shillong City. So definitely, connectivity is improving. A lot of, roads in Meghalaya are beautiful. The Guwahati-Shillong Drive is beautiful. And we have the Shillong Nongstoin Tura Road, which is a beautiful national highway. I mean, many people have not seen it. And the other day I attended another seminar where people were saying, in a COVID situation, most people now want to drive. They don't want to go by air, they want to drive to destinations. So Meghalaya, with its scenic beauty, with its very beautiful landscape offers a beautiful destination for people just to drive and to reach destinations at their leisure. So we are trying to increase high value tourism when we get tourists who will come into the state and stay for a longer duration to increase the value, because we understand that in a COVID situation, the footfalls will decrease, but we are trying to, you know, upscale the infrastructure, upscale the capacity of our service providers and upskill them so that the quality of our tourism improves, including our destinations, and tourists are willing to pay more and increase their duration of stay, even if lesser numbers come in. So a guided tour, you know, a nice tour operator, those kind of services which will give you that feel that you are in, you know, you are in the midst of luxury, even in nature. So another thing we had, launched during the Meghalayan age was high-end glamping, you know, tents, because these can come up at many of our destinations and they don't take much time. And also they are eco-friendly and, you know, they kind of blend with the ecosystem, with the destination. So glamping is something that we are also looking at, and, you know, to build up glamping destinations in our state, especially closer to our caves and to our other beautiful tourist spots, including waterfalls.
So thank you, Mr. Sairil, for your expression and address. I now move on to our next speaker, Mr. Sachin Jadhav. He's Director of Tourism in Government of Odisha. And Odisha also has a movie to play. So I will request Mr. Rajkumar to kindly play the movie on Odisha.
Come home to nature. Come home to calm. Come home to the world of art and craft. India's best kept secret.
Thank you, Odisha, for a very short and very crisp movie. Well, Mr. Sachin, welcome to the session. And Mr. Sachin, Odisha is one of the states which has emerged on the national scene, on the national tourism map, much more than what it used to be a few years ago, even when I was Secretary of Tourism. The last 3-4 years have really been revolutionary, and you have become a very proactive state in all respects, in terms of tourism infrastructure, in terms of aggressive promotion, in terms of dealing with the industry. So can you please highlight your plans to further take up the unexplored potential destination that the state has? As we know, Odisha is very rich in eco and ethnotourism, in cultural tourism. In beach tourism also, not so much explored. And of course, Buddhist tourism is another one area. I remember we had given some money for infrastructure to develop Buddhist tourism in the state. So can you please highlight what are your plans with regard to the present situation and how to promote domestic tourism in the present state? Mr. Sachin.
Yeah. Good morning, sir. Good morning, everybody. And thanks for the kind words about Odisha. And my... let me express my sense of privilege to be part of this webinar. As you have rightly said, Odisha has been in discussion since last few years, yet there is a lot to be seen. Many people have heard about Odisha. Many people are yet to visit Odisha. So in these difficult times, we have firm belief that good days are ahead. And tourism is not only going to rebound, but it is going to make a, should I use the word, a fierce come back. As far as Odisha is concerned, our tagline is best kept secret of India. So in a sense, Odisha cannot just highlight one thing. It is a full of platter of things. As you have rightly mentioned about Buddhist heritage and forests and beaches, Odisha has 20 sanctuaries, 2 tiger reserves and 1 national park, offering scenic views and opportunity to sight wildlife ranging from 350 plus bird species at any single location, be it mangrove forest or Satpushcha tiger reserve, home to migratory birds in Chilka, which is Asia's largest brackish water lake, highest density of sea crocodiles found anywhere in the world, 2000 plus crocodile sea crocodiles found in 145 square kilometer of Bhitarkanika, which is unheard of. It is second largest mangrove forest of country. Satpushcha gorge, it is 22 kilometer long gorge. So if we keep talking of only forests, we will fall short of time. Odisha is so rich in forest. 40% of forest coverage is there in Odisha. We are a city of temples. Bhuneshwar is a city of temples with more than 1,000 temples and more than 100 active temples. The oldest active temple of the country is situated in Odisha, from 7th century. And there are temples which have still evidence of old and ancient traditions of even Naramedha, Ashwamedha. These evidences are there. And Odisha presents a kaleidoscope of historical evolution right from the early days of when Samrat Ashoka, after Kalinga War, he was converted to Buddhism and he started the spread of Buddhism through the world. So even if Lumbini, Gaya and Varanasi, these are called the major locations of Buddhist destinations, still Dhauli, Pushpagiri, Lalitgiri, Udaygiri, Ratnagiri, they are still understated destinations, because the spread of Buddhism as we know today, it has started from Odisha and not from Gaya or not from Lumbini. Not to demean any other location, but Odisha and these locations, they deserve their rightful place as far as Buddhism is concerned. And it is a very accessible route. Along the National Highway 16, all these locations are located. If you travel from Calcutta to Chennai, you can access not only beaches and not only the mangrove forest, but you can access these Buddhist locations also. So it is strategically placed. So keeping this in mind, and these monuments, temples, beaches, these are the primary things. And I will come to the forest and ecotourism a bit later. But considering the strategic location of these places, we have devised road itineraries. And when we are devising road itineraries, it is not only about the tourists from Odisha within itself. Tourists from Ranchi, Jamshedpur, Kolkata, Raipur, Bilaspur, Vizag, these neighboring locations, they form a part of a closed circuit wherein the tourists from neighboring states, they can easily access by road these places. And we have devised various road itineraries. So right now on our platter, 10 itineraries ready. These itineraries are formulated considering the leisurely time of travel of a person. If one starts from the morning, leisurely if he travels, he can cover 400 to 500 kilometers in a day. So our itineraries, they consist of all the details of important destinations on the place, distances from petrol pumps, mechanic garages facilities, health clinic facilities, police stations, accommodation facilities, all these things. Plus, we are in the process of preparing a software wherein a tourist can form his own itinerary by a drop-down menu. He can select his destinations, he can select his road. And there will be a 24-hour helpline for the tourist to access to. So I believe these road itineraries will give a good boost for tourism to hitherto less known locations in Odisha. Along with that, we are thinking of promoting caravan tourism also. So infrastructure in place. And coming to this, what Meghala had mentioned, glamping. Last year in December to February, for 3 months, we had a glamping event organized on the beach of Konar, which was received extremely well. Our occupancy for 2 months was 89% for the first year of the event. Encouraged by this response, we are going to replicate it at four locations this time. Bhitarkanika Mangrove Forest, Debrigarh Sanctuary, which is situated on the Hirakud Water Reservoir, Satpushcha Gorge on the sandbars, and Daringbadi, which is a hill station kind of pristine location in central Odisha. The advantages of Odisha that we need to highlight, and we are highlighting it, is that in times of corona, Odisha is having the least morbidity rate and least spread of COVID. So very good responsive administration across the state, hospitable people, peace-loving people. The crime rate of Odisha is one of the least in the country. And most importantly, the road conditions in Odisha, in this part of the country, is excellent. So it's a pleasure driving down the roads. I am myself an avid traveler, and I have drawn down the corners of Odisha in my own car and motorcycle. So I guarantee from my own side, and we are taking on board our stakeholders in Odisha, and we are in discussion with these things. Odisha cuisine is another area which needs attention. And in these terms, recently we have organized a webinar with stakeholders. And another chapter of that webinar, the same concept, will be taken on World Tourism Day. And we are going ahead on this front, involving the Odia diaspora across the world, so as to popularize the Odisha cuisine. And we are mapping Odia cuisine for their special localities. You know, the sweets that are popularly known as Bengali sweets, they have their origin. Most of the sweets have their origin in Odisha. And we are highlighting those things to give the rightful place on the tourist map. Archaeological sites, coming to that, the three important sites at Jashpur, Lalitgiri, Udaygiri, and Ratnagiri, which is called Diamond Triangle. The ancient University of Pushpagiri, it was located at that site. And massive efforts are being taken from Odisha Tourism now to document all those things and bring it on tourist map. It is not just the remains. It's about the live history and evolution of history. And we are undertaking trainings in batches of guides from the local communities and naturalists also, so that nearby forest areas, mangrove forests, they can be explored properly. Odisha has a very successful model of ecotourism. We have 41 locations situated inside forests, which are run by local communities. It is a community-run model, and Forest and Environment Department, in coordination with Odisha Tourism, they are running this model. It is extremely successful. 50% of the profits are used for community development. And some villages in Nayagarh district, they have recently received accolades across the world for their community initiatives and keeping their villages self-sustainable and clean. So Odisha, to sum up, it has huge variety of things to offer as far as tourism is concerned. Not a single thing that can be talked about Odisha. And we are taking steps in terms of eco-retreat glamping, road trip itineraries, caravan tourism, day picnic products, and to give boost to local communities and eco-friendly and sustainable model of tourism. We have already formed a homestay policy. So many tourists nowadays, they are in search of some adventure, some kind of, everybody wants to mix up with the communities and take a different experience. So in that regard also, homestay policy is there, and there is a provision of mentoring to these homestay operators. We are going to train them also. So in gist, this is what Odisha has to offer, and this is what Odisha tourism is taking steps.
Thank you, Mr. Sachin, for describing all the strategies and the plans that you have. Thank you very much. We now move on to our third speaker from Chhattisgarh, Mrs. Shubha Chaturvedi. There would be a video of Chhattisgarh, and then I will put a question to Mrs. Shubha for her to respond. Can we have the movie, please? And I would request all the panel speakers kindly to keep a track of the timings. We have to complete at 11:30, and we would certainly wish to have some questions as well. So, am I audible?
In the heart of our country lies the state of Chhattisgarh.
It is a state that might be politically young in years, but it is a land where mysteries tend to unfold at every step. where history awaits to be discovered at every turn and pours forth its bounty as the journey progresses. From a slice of tribal heritage and fascinating handicrafts to archaeological treasure mines and sites, the journey into this land is an eye-opener for the seeker of wisdom and knowledge. There are few states in the country which have been blessed by nature as Chhattisgarh. A shade greener than most part of the country, a large part of the state is under forest cover. From taking a boat ride at the base of a stunning waterfall to driving through the enchanted woods of wildlife sanctuaries, Chhattisgarh is a land awaiting to be explored. We have tried to cover what the state had to offer, its history, culture and nature. Chhattisgarh, simply speaking, is a land which is full of surprises.
In the heart.
Thank you, Chhattisgarh, for the lovely film. Mrs. Shubha Chaturvedi, if she's online. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you, sir.
All right.
Am I audible, sir?
Welcome. My question is, Chhattisgarh is a known hub, as we have seen in this film as well. It's a hub for ecotourism, nature tourism, ethnotourism, tribal tourism. I think it is the model state for showcasing tribal tourism, and it's an emerging state. Fortunately, COVID has also not impacted so much this state particularly, and you are all working very proactively. You are also looking after promotion and marketing and communication. So how do you see, in the light of the present situation, how would you promote and market domestic tourism and those destinations which have been so far lesser known? In fact, I would say that Chhattisgarh, again, just like many other parts of the country, itself is a lesser known state and lesser known destination as well as tourism is concerned. So your task becomes more challenging to showcase more or less all the destinations that you have to the outside world. And of course, within Chhattisgarh, you have a large scope for people to go and visit these tourism jewels which are lesser known. So can we have your views, please, Mrs. Shubha?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Namaskar and a very good morning to you all. It's a matter of great pride for me to share this platform with the most experienced persons from the tourism and hospitality sector. Sir, I represent here a very beautiful state of India, that is Chhattisgarh. It is full of surprises and full of hidden gems. As you have rightly remarked, that Chhattisgarh is unexplored. Very less people know about Chhattisgarh as a major tourist hub and a very beautiful tourist destination. This is one of the most untouched, unexplored, uncrowded destinations, and that makes this destination an ideal destination to visit in this era of pandemic. There is so much so hidden about this place that it would be difficult for a person to explore this region in one go. With nearly half of the state covered under forest and nearly 32% of indigenous population, it offers immense opportunities for eco-ethno, adventure, cultural, and rural tourism. The USPs of the state are the expansive forests and its natural water bodies. It is the home to indigenous flora and fauna, and we have the species of medicinal plants and herbs which are found in abundance here in Chhattisgarh. We boast of ethnic population. Chhattisgarh ranks 8th in terms of the density of PVTG, that is particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So we have created a tribal circuit under Swadesh Darshan Yojana, and it encompasses the entire length and breadth of Chhattisgarh from north to the south of Chhattisgarh. We have created some very beautiful destinations in this circuit. Another USP of Chhattisgarh is its unexplored and exotic tourist destinations. When we talk of unexplored and exotic tourist destinations, first thing that comes to mind is like the cave tourism. We have in Meghalaya, we have it in Chhattisgarh as well. So we have some very beautiful stalactite and stalagmite caves in the southern part of Chhattisgarh, that is in the Bastar region. And these are so beautiful, and some of them look as if they are crafted by hand, by the human hand. we have the cave paintings dates back to the 12,000, with a history of 12,000 years. Another hidden treasure of Chhattisgarh is the Jashpur and Sanna region in the northern part of Chhattisgarh. These are vast green landscapes and which have the capacity to mesmerize anybody or every person. So we have some other sites as well, that is Karkabhat. It is a megalithic burial site which is full of beautiful manhirs. The third largest Lord Ganesha statue in the world, made of single sandstone, also lies here in Chhattisgarh in the Baswur. Very few people are aware of the fact that Lord Rama has spent some period of his 14 years of exile in Chhattisgarh. We are developing Ram Van Gaman Path for the places he visited. So when we talk of hidden gems, we also talk about the arts and crafts, the festivals, the cuisine, the tribal games, the tribal lifestyle, and the experiences. Tourism here in Chhattisgarh is mostly based on experiences. Our arts and crafts dates back to the Harappan civilization. We have got Bastar Dashara, which is one of the most important festivals of Chhattisgarh, and it is celebrated for almost 75 days. And the most interesting part of this festival is that it has nothing to do with Ram and Ravana. The entire festival is celebrated to worship goddess Danteshwari. Danteshwari Devi is the goddess of Bastar region of Chhattisgarh. We have this rich Chhattisgarhi cuisine as well. Some tribal dishes are also unique in itself. So we have so hidden things, so hidden jewels in Chhattisgarh that I think to preserve these destinations, we have to have a carrying capacity analysis for these regions. Otherwise, they will lose its appeal. The entire pattern of traveling is changing now. So there is a kind of paradigm shift. People used to regard eco-travel and various other forms of nature-based touristic travel, like camping, caravan, homestays, rural tourism, as the niche segments of tourism. But now we think that is a new normal. Since I belong to the marketing and promotion team of the Chhattisgarh Tourism Board, we are promoting aggressively these lesser known destinations. In fact, we are full of archaeological sites, beautiful Buddhist destinations as well, beautiful landscapes, vast green landscapes we found here in Chhattisgarh. But we think that the lesser known destinations should come onto the tourism map of India. We are doing a lot of marketing, a lot of promotional activities to develop these destinations and making people aware of these destinations. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Mrs. Shubhda. And I really liked your idea of putting lesser known destinations on tourism map. We can certainly, from FICCI, and I can also use my contacts with the tourism ministry to suggest this. So it's a good takeaway. So thank you very much. Now I would request Mr. M.R. Mohanty. He's the co-chairman of FICCI Tourism Committee, and also he's the CNMD of Swasti Group. Mr. Mohanty, I believe you have a PowerPoint presentation also, but meanwhile, to save time, I would meanwhile put some questions before you, which you can cover in the PPT or maybe otherwise verbally as well. Firstly, what according to you are the major attractions in eco and wildlife space in Odisha? Number two, my question is that Odisha has Chilka Lake, which to my mind is still not getting as much footfall as it deserves. So can you play something, can you say something about as to how this destination can be promoted in the present situation for domestic travelers? And thirdly, you are heading a huge hotel chain, Swasti Group, and it's a huge success in Odisha. So with COVID around and Swasti being a role model, what is the level of preparedness of your hotels to convince the consumers and the visitors that they should be confident about staying despite the COVID threat? And what exactly is the secret of success? as to how Swasti has done so well in the state of Odisha. So these are some of my questions. Maybe you will like to answer them. Mr. M.R. Mohanty.
Thank you, Mr. Jutsi. I am J.K. Mohanty.
I'm sorry.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
You see, Dr. Mehta, our director, has shown what Odisha is. I don't think I should repeat those things, but I will only say, like to take this platform to thank Mrs. Suri for putting pressure on Fiki and others to have such a program on where we are all here on Zoom and we are all able to connect with each other. So a special thanks to Fiki and Mrs. Suri for giving all time from our busy schedule to be with us at this moment. As we have seen the Chhattisgarh, Meghalaya, I think Odisha has similar, more or less similar things to offer. Odisha has similar things to offer. And you see, Odisha is one state which has everything which rest of India has to offer. It has beaches, temples, mountains, tribal tourism, wildlife, forest, the largest lake in the northern hemisphere. Everything is here. My speakers who spoke before me from Meghalaya, from Odisha, and from Chhattisgarh have said more or less similar things. But one thing about Odisha is people think Odisha is a backward state or a poor state. And as Mr. Jutse asked, what is so happening in that state and what is, how Chilka Lake popular? I think we have come out with one of the best resorts in India on Chilka Lake. Since Mr. Sachin Jadhav has already spoken about the tourism potential, I will show you a small film on the infrastructure that we have. I'll just show this video film to you to show the infrastructure that we have.
Natural beauty and landscapes.
Manish, we can't see any
beaches.
Rajkumar, we are not able to
Maybe we can move on and show the film later.
Yeah.
Some technical glitch.
Yeah. Mr. Mohanty, you may share your views verbally, I mean, like that.
Well, I can make a PowerPoint presentation if video is not there. I have a small PowerPoint presentation.
Well, you may, I would suggest that you better, you know, share your views verbally because the time is running out and we have three more speakers, please. So I would prefer, and if you have PPT, please, if you can just expedite. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I will expedite it. Chilka Lake is the largest brackish water lake in the northern hemisphere. This lake is about 1100 square kilometers. And this lake, from the month of November till February, migrants from all over the world, and a lot of tourists come to this place to see, to enjoy the lake and its surroundings. These are some of the places where one can go and visit during the visit to Chilka Lake. Mangalajodi is a bird paradise, Nalabana bird sanctuary, the Ramha is also, it's a OTDC property. Kalijai temple is inside the lake, in the middle of the lake. Tapani Taratarani temple is nearby, where one can go and see the Taratarani. These are the places where people can go while they are staying in Chilka Lake. The Odiat Museum, Black Bugs at Betnai is there in hundreds. Then Taptapani hot water sulfur spring, you see this is there in OTDC Pantanivas Taptapani, where people come and once they put their foot into the hot sulfur spring, a lot of diseases are cured. Jirang Monastery, Chandragiri, is the largest monastery in Eastern India. You have Gopal, besides Puri, you have Gopalpur Beach, which is another pristine beach in Odisha. I'm going fast. These are some properties of the Swasti Group, Chilka Resort, Swasti Premium, Gopalpur, Swasti Grand. Then we have the Bhitarkanika, which is the largest mangrove forest, forest with crocodiles. And National Geographic has made a film on this and they have called this place a mini Amazon. Chandrika is near to Bhubaneswar. It has a bird, elephant sanctuary. And Sakgaon, these are the near camps put up by the forest and forest department. We have Simlipal Tiger Reserves.
Mr. Mohanty, can we wind up, please? Just your few remarks before we shift to the next speaker, please, because the PowerPoint is also not working. Okay. Well, Mr. Mohanty is not reachable. Meanwhile, I will pass on to the next speaker. Mr. Suyash Keshari, are you there, Mr. Suyash?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Suyash, very, very short question. You are a renowned wildlife filmmaker and presenter. Who would know better than you about nature, eco, biodiversity, about wildlife of India, which is the real tourism jewels of this country? And it is also understood that, you know, ecotourism, wildlife tourism, nature tourism is going to prosper more in the present stage, you know, where crowding is not required. So how do you see is the preparedness and how you think domestic traveler can move on to these themes, especially wildlife in the present situation? And how do you think you could promote? Are we prepared for this movement of domestic travelers in the midst of COVID crisis? Like to have your views.
Yeah, so great question. I have been in Bandhavgarh National Park for the past 2 months. And this is situated in Madhya Pradesh. And in the background, I'm just going to be playing some of my beautiful photographs to encourage people to travel to these beautiful destinations. I think places like these are perfectly suited for a pandemic era. The reason being that there are very few people who come to places like these. The social distancing norms are always maintained because there aren't many crowds like you would see in an area like a temple or other tourist destinations. So this is a place in Madhya Pradesh. I grew up in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. And there's so much wildlife and so much beauty in these places that is completely unexplored. We always think about Africa or South America when we think about wildlife, but we forget the amazing destinations we have right here in India as well. So these are some of the photographs. What I wanted to do was, because in the interest of time, the new concept that is playing out is virtual tourism. And how I have taken to it is, like, as a very young person, I moved back from United States to India with one goal, and that is to take people out on virtual safaris and get them to fall in love with the same rural, raw, untamed India that I fell in love with. So how I've done that is through the virtual safaris. I've tracked hundreds of tigers in central Indian landscape. I know them. I feel like I've grown with them. So there's a series that I made called Safari with Suyash, and I won't show the clips because of the problems that we're facing, but I encourage people to, after this webinar, open your TVs, go onto YouTube, go onto WWF International, and watch this 5-part series, which will take you on a virtual safari to Bandhavgarh National Park. Together, we can learn about tracking tigers. And really, this is the kind of future I see in terms of content and also tourism as well, because I feel like once you get people addicted to a place virtually, they'll be more inclined to visit it physically as well. So yeah, I just wanted to put that out there in the interest of time, and I'll take some more questions from you instead. People, you can take a screenshot here, watch my series and connect with me directly doing this.
Excellent, Mr. Suyash. In fact, it was very insightful. And the best part about your presentation is that you have actually virtually taken us through a safari, and with those beautiful pictures of the wildlife, I think it's been a treat, speaking to you. Thank you so much. If we have questions, we'll certainly address to you. So sure. The next speaker would be Mr. Sajeev Kuru. Mr. Sajeev, Kerala has always been a leader. Are you there, Mr. Sajeev?
Yes, I'm very much here, sir.
Yeah, welcome. Kerala, Mr. Sajeev, has always been a leader in tourism, more so in Ayurveda and wellness space. And today, health and wellness is the topmost priority of the people amidst COVID. And this vertical is going to see a massive growth in the coming days. So how do you think, when we open the domestic tourism, how do you think that people are going to respond more than, visiting or maybe consuming other? And what is your preparedness in your particular, in your destination and in your state? How do you see the possibility of people visiting you and the domestic travelers coming from all over the country? If you can share your views, please.
Thank you very much, and very, very good morning to all. Representing the Ayurveda sector, especially from Kerala, you all are aware that, the Kerala's placement in the post-scenario as well as COVID scenario, we have developed a very clear pathway, which has set an example to all over the world in the line of controlling the pandemic. And we've succeeded, but last 2 weeks, like other states also, we are having some issues of getting it back. But the tourism sector generally in Kerala, we are all set to open. In the sense, already some people have already started because with the domestic. That means, the clients inside Kerala started going and exploring Kerala. Most of the people are not aware, and we have given a special package for the domestic airline clients to move, because anyway there is not much activities, and most of these places are having Wi-Fi. So it is working at home, a changed scenario to working in a touristic place. It has given some sort of business and everything to places like Munnar, Tekadi, hill stations of Wayanad and all. That's the first phase. Now, since it is going to open the borders, we expect more clients to travel across the border by road. So we have found SOPs, and we are already in the line of having COVID negative certificates. certified once they cross the border. Either they can bring the COVID negative certificate or they can get benefit from the preference which the government of Kerala has given for the tourists to have ICMR approved labs to give the COVID negative certificates. And so with the COVID negative certificates, people can enter. And we expect this to commence from 15th of August. That is for the domestic clients. So regarding the international clients, as Madam Suri knows, our season starts from October. And the tremendous number of inquiries which all of us are having, especially for the rejuvenation and post-COVID detoxification programs, people from different parts of the world, they are just waiting for the international flights to start. So we envisage a very good turnaround once it opens. Maybe it may be from next year onward. That means first of January. And Kerala is always, you know, we are thinking a little bit better than the other people in the sense of to set the targets. We are now doing the virtual platform and to give emphasize to give the priority for the post-COVID detoxification programs and also the immunity development programs through Ayurveda, which is going to give a very good response from both domestic as well as international market.
Thank you. Have you finished, Mr. Sajeev?
I finished your question, sir.
All right. Are you?
I don't want to give a study on Ayurveda.
Thank you, Mr. Sajeev. It was very enlightening, and thanks for your remarks and your suggestions. Our last speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is Mr. Jaspreet and Mr. Jaspreet Singh Bhatia. Welcome, Mr. Jaspreet.
Thank you, sir.
Well, you represent travel trade today, and though based in Chhattisgarh, as I could see from your website, you are marketing destinations pan India. Now, travel trade has taken the biggest jolt after hospitality and aviation in the present crisis. How prepared are you and how prepared is the travel trade, Mr. Jaspreet, to commence domestic tourism at this stage? And how would you market and promote the lesser known destinations in your vicinity and pan India to the health conscious people of this country for promoting domestic traveling? Can you please share your views?
Well, thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to congratulate Fikki for organizing this, and especially Dr. Suri for, you know, taking up this issue so that destinations like Chhattisgarh, which are lesser known, get a chance to come onto the national scene. Now, coming down to your question, sir, I think we don't have a choice and we don't have any other option. We cannot just sit and wait for the next 6 months for the international tourism to start. So the way forward, and I would say COVID has come up like a blessing in disguise for destinations like Chhattisgarh, which has always been there around the corner, but nobody looked at them. So this has given an opportunity for all the travel agents to rediscover the domestic tourism, and very much highlighted in your opening remark, you know, that these destinations have already been there in your district, in the vicinity of 100, 200 kilometers, but you never visited. So this has given a chance for the travel agents to rediscover them, to highlight them, to market them. And, you know, all the things that COVID has given rise to, like you would like to travel privately, you'd like to travel for shorter distances, you'd like to travel to places which are less crowded, you'd like to stay at properties which are not huge, which has less number of people. And, you know, small things like which have individual cottages, so the air conditioning is individual and not a duct air conditioning which can spread things. So if you look at all these facts, Chhattisgarh is kind of a destination which has all those elements. And on top of it, the connectivity is also very good. So as you said, the travel trade is now looking for all these domestic things, and international is not happening now. So there's nothing else that can be done. So we are just trying to promote it. We are promoting a lot of weekend trips. We are promoting a lot of day trips around your cities, around your destinations, which one can visit and one can feel refreshed.
So thank you, Mr. Jaspreet. Mr. Anirban, we have almost 3 minutes to go. So we can take one or two questions. One of the questions which has come to us is, what are the measures for tourism development in Odisha and Chhattisgarh post-COVID? And whether any of these states have any plans to make economic revival in tourism, any specific policy and SOP by the states with respect to tourism in line of COVID? Now, this is one question which has come from audience. So I would request first Odisha Director of Tourism, very briefly, please, 1 or 2 minutes, and then followed by Mrs. Shubhda from Chhattisgarh. Odisha first, please.
Yeah. Definitely, the Odisha tourism is taking steps to revive tourism. And in this respect, I have already mentioned about these road itineraries. The road itineraries will not be successful unless the stakeholders are promoted. So there will be a lot of private properties also on the way, ecotourism properties on the way. Local communities will get support because of this initiative. The glamping festival that was successful last year in Konark Beach, we are going to replicate it at 5 places, including mangrove forest, gorge, then Debrigarh Sanctuary, Daringbadi, these areas are less frequented by tourists. So by advocating glamping festival at these places, so local tourism will also get benefit of that. That is what we think. Next, most important thing that I forgot to mention earlier is along the beaches, that is 480 kilometer of coastline of Odisha, along the beaches, we are having this beach shack policy getting ready. So with this beach shack policy, day tourists as well as the night halt tourists coming to the nearby locations, they will definitely like such places. As Mr. Bhatti was saying, people will look for such places which are less crowded, leisurely, and in this post-COVID scenario. So we are planning to develop these kind of things. Bhitarkanika estuarine waters and other water bodies of Odisha like Hirakud Reservoir, Chilka, these are ideal locations for cruising. So cruising and houseboat, this is one important measure that Odisha tourism is taking. I forgot to mention these things. So collectively, I believe that these measures are going to go a long way in promoting tourism industry in Odisha. And at present, the share of tourism in GDP of the state was about 9 to 10% estimated. So in coming days, we firmly believe that it will definitely cross 10%. Thank you.
Mr. Sachin, before you, I go to Chhattisgarh, I have another one or two questions related to the three states. Since you are already online, there is a question as to what is the plan to develop tribal tourism in your state? That is one. And secondly, the state still has, doesn't have too many hotels to cater to the requirements of all kinds of domestic travelers in terms of tourism infrastructure. So what is the state of Odisha doing on these two fronts?
Yeah. First, I will answer about hotels. So Odisha tourism policy was formed in 2016, this second version of that. And another version of that policy is coming recently. But before that, we have amended this policy by bringing the land allocation for hotels at par with our industrial policy resolution. So that way we have eased the process of allocation of land to hotels. And recently, the important brands are now coming to Odisha. ITC Hotel is almost complete in Bhuneshwar. That is one thing. Because of the single window system online with Indian industrial policy resolution, the hotels coming in the tourism sector, they are facilitated by this. This is one thing. As far as tribal and land bank is also created for tourism. So allocation of land for hotels, be it luxury brand hotels or budget hotels, the process has become very easy in Odisha. Second important thing is about tribal tourism. Tribal tourism is a sensitive subject. Without affecting the dignity of tribals, the tourism needs to be promoted. Tribals should not be presented as a showcase item to tourists. So we are treading a very cautious path on this. Nevertheless, the tribal communities, they must get benefit of tourism. They must get their deserving share in this. And at 41 locations, I have mentioned ecotourism. Most of these communities are tribal communities who are getting benefit of this ecotourism. So that way, we look at tribal tourism in such a way that tribal crafts, tribal art, they should be promoted. We have 30 districts and almost all the 30 districts have their district level festivals going over 15 days or 20 days every year. And tourism department supports those festivals which are organized by District Council of Cultures. And out of that, close to 70 festivals are tribal festivals. So these are the things.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sachin. I now call upon Mrs. Shubha to kindly answer the question that I had posed initially, and also, in addition to that, cover the promotion of tribal tourism and how the states can have more hotels. What is the policy and what are the steps taken by Chhattisgarh to have more of hotel infrastructure? Could you answer these three questions, please, Mrs. Shubha? Mrs. Shubha, are you online?
Please unmute yourself, Shubha. Unmute yourself, please, Shubha. Shubha, you're on mute. Yes.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah.
Yes, now you are.
So, have you heard what I said just now?
Should yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir. Yes, sir. I have already heard, sir. Sir, as you've already mentioned that Chhattisgarh is less impacted from tourism, our strategy would be to open interstate tourism first and then we'll come gradually open the interstate tourism for the domestic purposes. Sir, we have got some very beautiful roads and we are encouraging more of one-day trips and weekend trips. Sir, we already have launched our Chhattisgarh tourism, new Chhattisgarh tourism policy, and we are coming with a lot of hotels, private players are coming in Chhattisgarh, and we have also come up with our sectoral tourism policies like homestay policy and all, which will naturally give impetus to the tribal tourism sector as well. And our tribal circuit is already being developed and being promoted on the world level and on the domestic level as well. People are really, we have got an encouraging response from the people throughout the country people are visiting these places. And I think Jaspreet is there to add more on this about the tribal tourism circuit, what he wants to, portray in terms of tourism and travel trade in Chhattisgarh about the tribal tourism circuit.
Very nice. Thank you. Now I go on to Meghalaya. Cyril, can you also answer these questions, please? Mr. Cyril?
Yes, sir. So with hotels, we have a 100-room property coming up in Shillong, which is under construction. It was supposed to be inaugurated in September, but that delay now because of the lockdown. So this property has been taken over by Taj Group. So Taj Vivanta in Shillong. This will add to the rooms in Shillong especially. And with regard to the other places, sir, we are working on a PPP policy to attract investment, especially in the hospitality and hotel sector. We know that tourism sector will be a huge growth pillar for the state of Meghalaya and for the human resource of Meghalaya. This is our real forte, and we are working on those policies, sir, where we are creating land banks. And with those land banks, we can attract private partners to set up hotels and other such resorts in the state. Of course, keeping in mind the ecotourism and sustainable tourism potential of the state. So that's what we're doing, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Sairin. I think we will have to close here as far as questions are concerned. So I would, as a sum up remark, I'll take just 1 or 2 minutes. Let me first of all express my thanks to Dr. Suri for having picked up such a relevant and pertinent topic, which is I think the burning issue today as to how we trigger the domestic tourism. And nothing could be better than picking up those lesser known destinations which are lying in safer places. It was very nice talking to Mr. Randhir after a gap of time. And thanks to all the panelists for their insightful knowledge and expressions about the subject, about the topic. They were brief, they were to the point. The best part, the takeaway was for me and for everyone, is that a lot of confidence is coming out from the private sector, from the travel trade, from the government also, about the preparedness to not just begin the domestic tourism, in this country, but also to revive and put it on the fast forward mode. So thanks very much, all the panelists. Just to sum up, I would again reiterate the points which most of us have discussed today. Let us, in the present situation, living with the COVID, make use of the unlocking of the economy, unlocking of tourism, activities which have been allowed by the government, and make the best use of it. Identify the safe destinations, ensure health infrastructure in those safe destinations, follow SOPs to convince and to build the confidence of the consumers and the travelers so that they can visit. Because even if we set up the destinations with all the health infrastructure, the fear among the consumers and the travelers has to be allayed, has to be brought down. And then, of course, once we have done this, we have to go for aggressive promotion. So friends, it was an excellent discussion. And in terms of when we speak of domestic tourism, ladies and gentlemen, it is not with the view that it is only because of COVID that we are focusing on domestic tourism. You know very well, Ministry of Tourism, when I was there, later on, all the more Honorable Prime Minister of India has been speaking about domestic tourism and Dekho Apna Desh, and all kinds of campaigns have been launched. So domestic tourism is one space, one area, which is many more times. In fact, if I may put a statistic before you, we had already covered 2 billion domestic tourist visits compared to 10 million of inbound tourism. 200 times more. So can imagine the intensity of domestic tourism, how much it is contributing to the Indian economy. So whether COVID or no COVID, domestic tourism has to be our topmost priority, and all the more because today domestic tourism is the only option for all of us. So let us begin with that confidence which we have shown today in this 1 hour session on a very important topic. So thanks everyone, all the panelists, Dr. Suri, Mr. Randhir Vikram Singh, and all the viewers and participants for their questions and for giving time to watch this session. Thank you very much.
So that brings us to the close of a very, very special session. Very clearly, we have been able to put the spotlight onto the jewels and tourism jewels of India. We chose destinations which I'm so myself unaware of. Meghalaya, Cyril, you mentioned it's a caving, which is absolutely a very, very interesting concept. And I think we do need to take a step towards that. However, the infrastructure perhaps could get a little bit better for people to come in. But I like the idea of a personalized tour guide. I think that would really help. Mr. Sachin Jadhav, Odisha is no doubt India's best kept secret. And there is great forest and temples. But what I like is your thought of engaging the local population. Shubhda, Chhattisgarh, I mean, one of the unknown secrets which I'm aware of is that it was Lord Ram's Nanihal. And I think it's so important for the Ram Trail to be able to include a visit to Chhattisgarh. So thank you very much. Yes. The stalactites and the stalagmites also extremely interesting. I think we need to get a little bit more infrastructure in place before we actually can get people to come to Chhattisgarh. Mr. Mohanty, thank you so much. It's not a backward state, Orissa, and it does have a great infrastructure. We are fully aware of that. So Yansh, you took us on a virtual tour, and I think that was really, really very exciting. So thank you so much for that. Kerala, Ayurveda, Mr. Sajeev, I mean, we don't have to talk much about it. I think we are all looking forward to getting to Kerala so that we can actually enjoy a little bit of unwinding after this pandemic, which has really scared all of us. Jaspreet, thank you so much. You have reiterated exactly what we've been saying throughout the conclave, and that is domestic tourism. It is domestic tourism, and we firmly believe that it is domestic tourism that will become the torchbearer for reigniting the Indian economy. So thank you very much, esteemed panelists. It was a very, very interesting session. Thank you for joining us. Stay safe, stay healthy, and thank you, participants, for being with us. Mr. Zuchi, thank you once again for taking this on for us. Thank you. Namaskar.